okay, so this is either the start of a new walk on February 23rd, 2022, or it's a continuation of yesterday's walk from 4th Avenue, 9th Street to the Food Bazaar in Red Hook. We're starting today at the Food Bazaar in Red Hook. We're at the corner of Beard Street and Conover Street. We're looking east on Beard Street. And now we're going to be walking north on Conover. We are walking north on Conover. There's no subway service in this area, so the closest stops are 4th Avenue and 9th Street, which is a mile and a half from here, easily, and I don't know. So we're going to turn down Van Dyke Street for a second. Because we are intrigued by the sign across the street for Steve's Key Lime Pie. I've walked or biked past this structure many times before. I have no idea what it is. Former industrial or warehouse buildings. But now home to winery and other businesses and Steve's Key Lime Pie. It is very sweet. If you like key lime pie, it's great. You don't have to walk here to buy it. You can get it in many local grocery stores. It's packaged in either full-size pie, full-size being 10 inches maybe less, and an individual pie. Let's go to the water's edge because this is Valentino Park and Valentino Pier, and someone riding a bike on the sidewalk. And in the background, Statue of Liberty, the Staten Island Ferry. Let's just go on a little bit of the pier and watch your step. And we're going to pause while I take an important safety break to tie my shoes. Okay, back at Valentino Park and Pier. And in the interest of full disclosure, I did have to stop to retie my left shoe. The full disclosure part being, I had already double knotted my shoes before leaving home. The park is named after Louis Valentino, a firefighter. I don't know what planned eventually for this facade. It's being held up artificially. I'm guessing some big building will be built behind it, and that will be the historic facade of the new building. Film shoot sign. Some film with the production name of Ghost or Ghost 2. Okay, as we continue northward, we're trying to stay as close to the waterfront as possible. And occasionally, if we get the chance, we will look out and see what we can see through the chain link fence. Don't know what's planned here. There aren't any signs up. this is temporary. Oh. Here's a no parking sign lying on the ground. It needs a home. Maybe I should take it home. And then all of this is, as it says, interim flood protection. This was put up after Sandy. I don't know what the permanent flood protection plan is in this area. So we're going to turn east on Sullivan Street. There's a bike lane painted on Sullivan Street. We're going to basically follow the bike path, which is part of the Brooklyn Waterfront bike path. So on this industrial block, you still, or primarily industrial block, there are three row houses, and it begs the question if there were more at a certain time. Okay, then coming up is a sign for bikers saying to go left for the cruise terminal, the Brooklyn cruise terminal. It's an ironworks establishment playing the Doobie Brothers. And here we have the two-direction bike path, bike lane. Part of the Brooklyn Waterfront bike route. We're on Conover Street heading north, and we're approaching the intersection of Pioneer Street. So if you're a pedestrian or a biker, this would be a good place to enter the cruise ship terminal. The cruise ship terminal being all the way at the end of this road on the right. And just beyond this tugboat, this red tugboat, is a canopied area, and that's the NYC ferry stop for Red Hook. So if you're arriving by ferry, NYC ferry at Red Hook, or if you're arriving from England on the Queen Mary. Watch your step. this is where you would exit. If you're in need of public transportation, you walk one block to Van Brunt Street and catch the B61 bus. There are no trains around here. So what do cruise passengers do when they come in? Uber, I guess. Maybe taxis in the old days. This is Pioneer Works, a performance venue. So the bike path is now to our left and elevated above us, Netherlands style. Building that we're approaching on the left used to be some kind of manufacturing building or shipping building, and it's now residential. Walking under the number of balconies that were added onto this building when it was converted to residential. Now the bicycle sign is pointing to Brooklyn Bridge Park. We're on Imlay Street now. Just a view of the balconies added to this building. This building, this very large, long building. The second sign I've seen so far saying that the maintenance of this bike path is sponsored by the O'Connell Organization. Now I'm curious, who is the O'Connell Organization, or what is it? It's pretty quiet. This is a Wednesday afternoon. It's almost 3 p.m. Here's an entrance to the Brooklyn Cruise Terminal. And still with the interim flood protection. Which makes me wonder, how are those two very large residential buildings that we pass, how are they protected on the water side? We're at the corner of Imlay and Summit Street, and we are going to be turning onto Summit Street because we have no other choice. Here, a Tesla parked right in the middle of the bike path. I didn't know Tesla owners were capable of doing such things. Or Tesla dealers. This is a Tesla dealer. We are now on Van Brunt Street again. And there's a little bit of debate about what this part of the neighborhood is called. We just passed Carroll Street, so I think some refer to it as Carroll Gardens. But the next neighborhood to the north, as in about 4 or 5 blocks, it becomes the Columbia Waterfront District. That's the name of the neighborhood. Where do you live? Oh, I live in the Columbia Waterfront District. This protected bike path was built fairly recently, about 5 years ago. Cranes in the distance, they're part of the Red Hook Container Terminal, but almost all of the container shipping business takes place on the other side of the Hudson River. We're going to wait for this truck. Then we're crossing onto Union. Street. Union Street. Fresh Direct truck on the left. FedEx on the right. So on this block is apparently a Malaya truck sales. Hence all the trucks here. All right. And on the same block, we have a unit of the fire department for its plant operations. This is Columbia Street. We're crossing Columbia Street because no visit to this part of Carroll Gardens would be complete if I didn't show you Ferdinando's Focacciaria, a Sicilian restaurant that has been in business at this very location since 1904. And again, serving Sicilian food. It's not a traditional red sauce Italian restaurant. Fernando's Focacciaria, since 1904. Delicious. We've had out-of-town visitors specifically asking to be taken there. BQE. Sunken below the streets. Don't recommend this, but I didn't want to wait for the light to change. west on 2nd Street. Those are what the local press might call redeemers. Looking for deposit containers. Those who know how to work most efficiently will go to collect containers on the night before recycling is collected. That's their best chance of finding a lot of deposit containers at once. Back on Columbia Street, heading north. Margaret Palka Bakes. We're on Columbia Street between 2nd and DeGraw. Margaret Palka Bakes, in our household's opinion, the best rugelach in the city. Again, continuing along the Brooklyn waterfront bike path. Which is along Columbia Street. We're now in the Columbia waterfront district. Gabrielli Rental and Leasing. Gabrielli is a major truck dealer in this region. They sell a lot of the trucks that the city uses, like sanitation trucks, trucks to other city agencies. They sell them, they service them under warranty. The place across the street is called Croc, K-R-O-K, and it says Thai street food. So let's remember where we are, Columbia and Kane. This building is the Waterfront Commission. That sounds pretty ominous. Remember, on the waterfront. Banners indicate that it's the 100th anniversary of the Port Authority. The Port Authority, besides operating tunnels and bridges in the PATH system, owns this waterfront area here. Signs that have only existed since 9/11, as far as I can recall. I don't know what MARSEC security level 1 is. Hopefully that's the lowest level. We have to make a little tricky maneuver here because the pedestrian and bike paths cross each other. Whew. That was close. This pedestrian path that we're on now used to be the combined pedestrian and bike path. And sometime in the last 10 years, the city created the separate bike path by building it out into one lane, one existing lane of the street, and separating it from vehicular traffic with these concrete barriers, which they've nicely painted, or let's see, commissioned this art studio to paint. The high rises to our left, residential buildings that were constructed in conjunction with the building out of Brooklyn Bridge Park, which we're about to enter. And it was all part of a long-term financing plan that has a portion of the revenues from these residential buildings and others that we will see newly constructed at more towards the north end of the park they help pay for the long-term maintenance of the park. Okay, we're going to wait for these bikes and then we're going to cross The sand-colored pavement is supposed to indicate a safe zone for pedestrians. This one's separated from the roadway by these planters. Down here, a little hard to see, is where the triple cantilever of the BQE begins. We'll see that much better later. Let's enter the park. I think the orientation signage here is pretty good. I like how this main entrance to the park is just two rows of benches and whatever. I don't know what these trees are, but you don't see anything of the water for now. You're just walking through this tree cover. Rat trap and fire hydrant, maybe they go together. Fornino is not parks terminology for restroom, but this is a restroom in the park, and there are other restrooms as we keep walking north through the park. We'll point them out. Beach volleyball. The beginning of the B63 bus. So it starts here and it goes down Atlantic Avenue to Fifth Avenue and eventually to Bay Ridge. And it's a long, long bus ride. Maybe 8 miles. Brooklyn Bridge Park has been built in stages over the last 20 years, approximately. The piers, you see, we started at Pier 6. And I should point out, Pier 6 is also a stop on NYC Ferry. It's called
what?
I don't remember what the ferry stop is named. I think it's Pier 6. Okay, well, that's a little embarrassing. But these used to be shipping piers that weren't used for shipping anymore, and they had fallen into disrepair. Here, the triple cantilever in the background, although right now it's just a two-level viaduct. The third cantilever level, which is the Brooklyn Heights Promenade, will become visible in a minute. Oddfellow's ice cream, maybe only seasonally operating. I don't know. It used to be an Ample Hills location. This is the picnic peninsula and barbecue area. You get some great views of Lower Manhattan here. Staten Island Ferry. Not a lot of barbecuing going on today. I also must mention that it is unseasonably warm today with a high of about 63, 64. And right now it's just about that temperature. Here's the beginning of the triple cantilever. Going to get in the bike lane for a second for a better look. But the pedestrian Brooklyn Heights Promenade is just beginning mid-screen. So I'm going to get out of the bike lanes. Glad I dodged all those bikes. We're going to exit Brooklyn Bridge Park. This structure straight ahead of us is a ventilation shaft for the subway for the Montague Street Tunnel, which serves the R train between Manhattan and Brooklyn. According to the sign on the door, it's the Furman Street fan plant. This is Furman Street at street level. And here's the triple cantilever. You can see all three levels. They're still standing. walk down here a little bit. So we're going south. We're going in a little bit of a, well, reverse direction. Because there are really only three ways to get to Brooklyn Bridge Park if you're in Brooklyn Heights at the top of the triple cantilever. There's a pedestrian bridge, which we'll see later, north of here. Remember, we're walking south. At the very northern end of the park, the Brooklyn Heights comes down to sea level, basically. And the third way is coming up here at the next corner, the traffic light at Joralemon Street. Joralemon Street goes from here up a fairly steep hill and through Brooklyn Heights and into downtown Brooklyn. And it is pronounced Joralemon, but it's spelled like Joralemon. And for my first 2-3 years of living in New York, I pronounced it incorrectly. I pronounced it Joralemon until a classmate of mine ridiculed me. Set of buildings like this one a little further south here when the BQE under which we just walked becomes depressed, that is sunken below street level. I guess the drivers get depressed too being on the BQE. And this part of Joralemon Street has retained its historic cobblestones. I'm guessing in part due to the steepness of this grade. I don't know if you can see. It's a fairly steep climb uphill for Brooklyn Street. And the construction of the triple cantilever and the promenade, I think, eliminated a lot of streets like Joralemon that went all the way through from Brooklyn Heights to the waterfront at one point, but I'm not clear on that. We're approaching Hicks Street, and we're going to turn left or north on Hicks. You may recall that just after Ferdinando's Focacceria, when we crossed over the depressed section of the BQE. The BQE actually runs at that point between the north and southbound lanes of Hicks Street. This is the same Hicks Street. It's quite a bit quieter here. We're in the Brooklyn Heights Historic District, as you can see from the brown street signs. Just passing Grace Court Alley. Going to turn left west on Remsen Street. Remsen Street is the, or Remsen Street provides, the southernmost entrance to the promenade. And we are going to southernmostly enter the promenade ourselves. I just have to point out, in Brooklyn Heights, the parking regulations differ from most other parts of the cities. I think due mostly to the streets being so narrow. So, hold on one second. So, on the north side of the street, it has parking permitted Tuesday, 8 to 6 p.m. only. But on the other side of the street, it's no parking Tuesday, 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. Or in other words, you can park any other time on this side of the street. And then we see here, a film shoot is going to take place. Production is called City on a Hill, season 3. And these cones marking off traffic are probably reserving parking spots for that film production. Last chance to escape from Remsen because it's a dead end. You don't get very many cul-de-sacs in this part of Brooklyn. Is this sign necessary or redundant? I mean, you can't tell us the end. It's the northbound traffic. Below that is the southbound traffic. We can't see that right now. Point where northbound traffic narrows from 3 to 2 lanes in order to minimize the tonnage going over the triple cantilever. The triple cantilever needs to be replaced with something. It's in very poor condition. And the city and state have been, and community have been unable to reach agreement on how to fix it. Because fixing it means taking it out of service somehow, or portions of it out of service. And where does all that traffic go? Does it go through neighborhood streets? Does it go on a temporary roadway? Where will the temporary roadway be built? Other than that, everything's fine. So, on the Brooklyn Heights Promenade, we have plenty of seating, and the houses, which are on a street called Columbia Heights, not Columbia Heights Street, just Columbia Heights, period. And this is the Montague Street Playground. There are restrooms here, but they appear to be closed. And if you're an adult unaccompanied by a child, I'm not sure you're allowed in there. So for every house that abuts the promenade, you have the first line of defense here. The iron gate that runs the length of the promenade. And then you have other layers of gates in back. And a lot of these houses have patios that are sunken below eye level.
But it seemed to veer towards my
So just so we don't miss the parts of Brooklyn Bridge Park that we're not actually walking through, By the way, we're not near any subway station. The closest one would be Court Street on the R, but that's at least a half mile away. Want to see across the river to South Street Seaport and the new Seaport building and the Brooklyn Bridge. Brooklyn Bridge was named after this park. Why is there a sidewalk shed in the park area? I can only imagine that there has been something inspected to be wrong with the facade on that building. A street called Columbia Heights, and this bench area here is called the Fruit Street sitting area. Fruit Street because the surrounding cross streets are named Cranberry, Orange, and Pineapple. In fact, this structure here is a ventilation shaft for the A and C train between Brooklyn Heights and Manhattan. The tunnel that the A and C train use is called the Cranberry Street Tube. Playground. Harry Chapin, the singer, with the hits Taxi, Cats in the Cradle. I don't know what his connection to this neighborhood is, if any. He was killed in the 70s while driving, I don't know on what highway, and something fell off the back of a vehicle in front of him and killed him. So this is useful. This tells you how many minutes walk the nearest subway stations are and the nearest city bike. So we're going down this ramp into the Squibb Street playground. I'm sorry, not Squibb Street Playground, just Squibb Playground. Or Squibb Park. and it's the Squibb of pharmaceutical fame, which we'll see in a minute. Edward Robin Squibb. Let's take the ramp down. This is a restroom. It appears to be open. And then with no direction or signage, we're left to find our own way to the entrance to the Squibb Park Bridge. This is the second of three ways of connecting Brooklyn Heights with Brooklyn Bridge Park. The bridge was constructed, I don't know, 10 years ago. It has been out of service for a long part of that time. You see it's got wooden boards on it. The boards and the combination of the bridge's structural design subjected walkers to excessive bouncing. I don't feel any bouncing now. And the bridge was taken out of service for several months, and there were some repairs made to it, and it was put back in service, but then it continued to bounce, so it was taken out of service again, I think for a period of more than a year. There was litigation against the bridge's designer by the Brooklyn Bridge Park Corporation, and the park's position was that the kind of wood that was called for in the original design contributed to the bouncing. I don't remember how it was settled or if it's settled, but anyway, it's open now. It feels stable. And then we'll take the stairs. And as I mentioned earlier, the park's long-term maintenance and operation is funded in part by revenues from these new residential buildings. So we're back in Brooklyn Bridge Park. Thank you. doesn't take much to attract a crowd in New York. I borrowed that line from a Charles Adams cartoon. We have the recently upgraded ferry stop for NYC Ferry, the Dumbo stop. Two ferries at once. I think that's why it was upgraded, in part to increase the capacity. A line of passengers waiting to get on. March music, a performance venue. The street signs are brown here, even though we're not in Brooklyn Heights anymore. Oh, by the way, must point out this was, I don't know what its original purpose was when it was built, but some kind of marine structure, but it was converted to the Brooklyn Ice Cream Factory maybe 20 years ago, and now it's an Ample Hills shop. The Brooklyn Ice Cream Factory moved across the street. And this neighborhood, and we're right now we're at the corner of Old Fulton Street and Water Street. This is the Fulton Ferry Historic District. So we just left Brooklyn Heights, and now we're in Fulton Ferry Historic District. Or as I call it, Pizza Row. I don't know anything about Ignazio's Pizza. But Shake Shack? No, they haven't expanded into pizza. But, Temptation. This pedestrian area was created in the last 10 years. So, Giuliana's Pizza, that's hard to explain, and it's almost next to Grimaldi's Pizza. And you can see a lot of people are willing to wait to get Giuliana's Pizza. Grimaldi's, not so much. Maybe they're not open yet. And as the sign says, no slices. That must be mostly directed at tourists. Natives of Brooklyn have known for years, decades, that Grimaldi's doesn't sell slices. Now, Do two famous pizza places constitute Pizza Row? Maybe. Maybe two do. To do. But without making a big to-do about it, there's a third opening up soon. Ellen B. Spumoni Gardens. Ellen B. Spumoni Gardens started in 1939 in the Bensonhurst Bath Beach neighborhood of Brooklyn. It is the place to go for Sicilian squares. Many consider it the best in the city, so I'm really eager to see them open up here and do a taste comparison. Anyway, Giuliana's versus Grimaldi's, because L&B pizza appeals to a different clientele because their signature pie is Sicilian squares, which neither Giuliana's nor Grimaldi's sell. They bake round, thin crust pizza. But Giuliana's was started, let's see, the Grimaldi family sold Grimaldi's, and the non-family operators carried on the name Grimaldi's. Then the Grimaldi family wanted to get back into the pizza making business about 15 years ago, and but they couldn't use the name Grimaldi's, so they called it Giuliana's. I don't know if Giuliana, don't remember if that's the name of one of the Grimaldi family members, or is it's just the name that they took. So this is still part of Brooklyn Bridge Park. This is called Time Out Market, I guess after the publication entertainment information source. But the buildings are called the Empire Stores, meaning for storage. These were warehouses in the Civil War. And now we're approaching Jane's Carousel. We've seen Jane's Carousel from two different bridges, and I think this is our first time approaching it at eye level, street level. It's closed today. As I said, it's Wednesday afternoon. I don't know if it's open on weekends. I don't know if it's seasonal. $2, and it looks like it's open Thursdays through Sundays. Good to know. So I have not been on foot here for a few years, and this is the first time I'm seeing Hudson Yards from this vantage point. That tallest building in the distance is one of the centerpieces of Hudson Yards. All right. So heading back to Time Out. We're going to enter there because I think it's time for a rest stop. All right, we've exited Timeout Market, formerly called the Empire Stores, and we're on Water Street in Dumbo. So we've cut through three neighborhoods, Brooklyn Heights, Fulton Ferry Landing, Fulton Ferry Landing, and Dumbo. The building across the street is 60 Water. It's a residential building with a public elementary school in the base. And at 66 Water Street, across the street, is Jacques Torres Chocolate. The street is very busy. Jacques Torres, Say No More. Again, Must Resist Temptation. I love their frozen hot chocolate. Their wicked frozen hot chocolate. Wicked, meaning it's spiced with pepper. So we're walking on Water Street in Dumbo. We're walking more or less north. The anchorage for the Manhattan Bridge. This sign. Welcome to Opmud. We're in an archway going through the anchorage of the Manhattan Bridge in Brooklyn. This thing that looks like a streetcar and says Dumbo Station on it is an active bar in season, I guess. Season excluding a Wednesday afternoon in late February, even if it is a balmy 60 degrees. And this signage is new, these posters. These buildings were mostly former manufacturing buildings converted to residential. This fenced area here on the bridge is, you can't see it, but it's the bike lane of the Manhattan Bridge. We're now moving from Pearl to Front Street. And again, this is a historic district. It's the Dumbo Historic District. We're on Front Street. Overpowering smell of baking bread here. In the interest of full disclosure. Okay, we're very near the end. We've been walking on Front Street, and now we're at the corner of J Street. So, for those who might remember, J Street Metrotech is a major subway station in downtown Brooklyn. We're not walking there, but we're walking to the station that's the next one before J Street Metrotech. But first, this building across the street, still under construction, takes up the entire block. This site was formerly owned by Jehovah's Witnesses, who moved their headquarters and operations from Brooklyn Heights and Dumbo upstate. They owned this lot. It was vacant or nearly vacant, and they sold it for some unprecedented price at the time. 10 years ago, 15 years ago, for somewhere between $800 million and $1 billion, just for the lot. this is one of the more unique subway stations. It serves two purposes. It's a ventilation tower for the F train, because this is the beginning of the Rutgers Tube, which is the name of the tunnel that carries the F train between Brooklyn and Manhattan. So this structure doubles as a ventilation tower for the Rutgers Tube and as the only entrance to the York Street station. We're at J Street and York Street, and this is the nice Art Deco entrance, because this station and the entire F train line were built in the 30s. This station, as you'll see, is pretty deep. How soon is the next train? Okay, 4 minutes. It may take us 4 minutes just to walk down to the platform. As I said, this station is deep. It took us 2 minutes to walk down those stairs. So, looking down the tunnel is the entrance to the tunnel going under the East River. And since 9/11, NYPD has put police booths like this on station platforms where the station is at the entrance to a tunnel under a river.
Thank you.
are very unusual in New York subway station. This is a Coney Island bound app, which will take to 4th Avenue and 9th Street. This sign covers a 1930s mosaic that says to Church Avenue, which is where this line ended when it was first built in the early 30s, before it connected to the Culver line and went all the way to Coney Island. So that's it on our walk through Red Hook. And we end here at the 4th Avenue 9th Street stop on the F, G, and R trains. This is infrared, and this is what you've been watching.